Hello all, Kadrina here. Today we're going to be discussing the book Nine Perfect Strangers by Liane Moriarty. I picked this book up as one of my Book of the Month credits for November 2018, so it's been sitting for a while, but I managed to read it within 5 days, so that's something. I couldn't put it down once I started. We'll get into that in a minute. My Book of the Month referral link is in the description box below. As usual, not sponsored, but I would love it if you sign up since we both get a book. Anyways, Liane Moriarty is the author of Little Big Lies, which was made into a TV show. I only mention this because she does it outside of a small blurb, and I'm interested in reading the book after watching snippets of the TV show. Anyways, Nine Perfect Strangers is a standalone book that is 450 pages long. It was marketed to me as more of a psychological thriller with multiple viewpoints, but despite the circumstance, it actually felt more like a slice of life for the first half of the book before it went off the rails. And there were only really three, quote, twist, unquote, which with only one of them being an actual twist. Anyways, there are obviously nine perfect strangers who decide to go to this health resort in their native Australia for a multitude of reasons to improve their life. We have who I would consider the main character. Her point of view takes up a little less than half of the book. Frances Welty, a down on her luck romance novel who's still stinging from being part of a romance scam. There's also the couple Ben and Jessica, who are poor until they won the lottery after Ben's mom bought them a lotto ticket after a home robbery, but their marriage is falling apart due to Jessica accusing Ben's sister of the robbery. It's actually quite sad because Ben gets her Lamborghini and seems to care more about the car than Jessica, which leads her to get botched plastic surgery to try and look good and get all some sort of shred of attention to him, only it pushes him farther away. There's also Lars, a pretty boy, divorced lawyer, who fights for the woman in his mother's honor after his father left them, but is also a health retreat junkie who is avoiding his partner Ray and his desire for kids. Frances has him pegged to a T with this brilliant line. Carmel was followed by an astonishingly handsome man with high cheekbones and flashing eyes who paused at the front of the room as if he were a movie star walking out onto the set of a chat show to rapturous applause. He was perfectly stubbled, perfectly proportioned, and deeply deservingly in love with himself. Actually, our first chapter with Lars was him preening and peacocking about how men's wives come to him and adore him, having a double meaning, of course. Then there is Carmel, a single mother of four with body dysmorphia who thinks she's fat since her husband traded up and is sickly optimistic about this whole thing. Then there's Tony Hogburn, a famous former football player who thinks he's estranged from his three children and has smiley face tattoos on his butt. And then finally we have the Marconi family. Napoleon is the teacher patriarch. Helen is the midwife matriarch. Zoe is their almost 21-year-old daughter. She actually does turn 21 in the course of this book. They're there to try to heal after their son and Zoe's twin brother Zach committed suicide, each of them blaming themselves for his death. He does also kind of make appearances through those three characters having conversations in their heads with him about it, mainly Zoe and Napoleon. Lastly, there is also the help, Yao, a former paramedic and Samuel Lee Jackson consumer, Delilah, a former personal assistant who is there for the money, and her former boss, Masha, the Amazonian Russian who founded the resort and is the resident fruitcake. So a lot of point of view characters, 12 to be exact. Really, I didn't think this was all that great of a book. A lot of the time you follow these characters' train of thoughts as they go on tangents, and unless it's Frances's character, can be clunky at parts, like it's trying to be witty and funny, especially when explaining the background information, where it's most like throwing an aside. Well, Frances kind of weaves the story in to her train of thought, kind of like, oh, I remember this time where my husband did this, like the yada yada yada, where the other ones are just kind of like, it all went wrong. Honestly, would you even be recapping this in your mind right now? Or honestly, if it weren't for that, the majority of this book was either Frances or Masha, I don't think I would have continued reading it. Because while the first couple pages were good, the middle bit of Yao's introductory chapter, which is the first chapter, turned me right off almost instantly. Remember earlier when I said he was a Samuel Lee Jackson consumer? His choice of insult is to call people a motherfucker. And I'm just like, so it's that kind of book. No, seriously, this book has very little cursing except for the couple times it says fuck. It's kind of weird, honestly, not in a jarring sort of way that I think it was entailed, just weird way to emphasize important moments when there's words like shit, damn, and asshole exists. See? Real easy to curse, and real easy to be creative and curse. Zach's essence has more creative insults, and he's a dead 18-year-old boy. Anyway, like I said, I enjoyed this book. I read it at a lightning speed of 90 pages a day, something I probably would have done regardless of the fact that I was on bed rest for having my wisdom teeth removed, because it was an easy read for the most part. Even the bad parts weren't that bad. It was a nice, simple book without a lot of thought. A slice of life of nine ordinary people, each with their hidden scars and each thinking someone else can save them from their misery. Cue Masha. So Masha was once a literal big cheese executive in a corporate world. Like, she literally sold cheese before she had a heart attack, and Yao's mentor, Finn, saved her 10 years before the events of this book. At the time, she claimed to have an out-of-body experience where she sees her dead son as an adult and a birthmark on Yao's head, which interested him enough to keep him in contact with her before joining as a medical staff at her resort 5 years later. Masha is so driven to making you the best you that you can be, she will be willing to do anything, which brings us to spoilerly plot and twist number one. Microdosing. Basically, microdosing is when you take 1/10 of a dose of Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, figure that out what that means, to make you more alert. Only she was microdosing her client without their knowledge or consent. Honestly, when the twist came out, I had to put the book down for a minute and thought, well, she's a serial killer. Honestly, in this case, it wasn't that the twist was not a good one, it was the fact that people protested and still went along with it despite Helen wanting to protect her daughter, Napoleon already having a bad trip the last time he took Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, and Ben having an
poor sister.
You see them protest, and then the next thing you know, in the very next chapter, they're all doing it. It comes off as very flat and strange. You can totally tell she writes this as an end of an episode of a show, but offers no explanation of how they got there in the next episode. Anyway, they wake up in a locked room where they try to fail to get out. This leads Masha to becoming increasingly upset at our stupid because any normal person would figure out her escape room in an hour. This kind of highlights how she gets becoming more and more unhinged. And Francis ends up solving the puzzles both times by finding the clue and then figuring out the door is unlocked and has been for hours. So my girl's got you. The second quote, twist, unquote, comes when Masha, high off her gourds on Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, and devises a plan to give them their own near-death experience for enlightenment and acts like the house is on fire with the clients trapped in the basement with no way out. Obviously, they're fine as Francis figures out the sound of the fire is on a loop and the door is unlocked, really the only one carrying this team at this point. So yeah, it's kind of underwhelming. I don't know if I would necessarily have liked her to actually start the fire, but I kind of saw it coming because, well, you got to commit possibly killing off your characters, and it's hard for a lot of people when they don't plan and they become attached to another characters, Francis included. Anyways, the third and final twist is the more interesting one that I would have liked to actually been explored a little bit more. So Masha is the way she is because she lost her son at 11 months old to an accidental strangling. Basically, he suffocated after playing in the blinds while unattended for a few minutes. Afterwards, she does the kind thing and divorces her husband, so he isn't with a neglectful mother. There are a couple mentions of her getting emails from him, who she's clearly fond of despite ignoring him, but at the end we finally see from his point of view through the adapt title of the man. I don't know why they use, because he has a name and she says the name several times, and it turns out she happened to be 6 months pregnant at the time with her second son. So she abandoned him and her husband and threw herself into her work while he marries an Australian woman and has 2 more sons. In my humble opinion, this was the actual twist, not some bullshit microdosing and fake fire thing that is half-baked and poorly executed. Overall, I think it was a cute book. I probably shouldn't be calling a Moriarty book a cute book, but I'm doing it. And I say, if you're looking for a fun read with low stakes and low expectations, this is a good book for you. Thanks for listening. Next up, I will be reviewing The Farfield by first-time author Madhuri Vijay. See you then.